Simba. Only go over there. This is the SOGOpod.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the SOGOpod. My name is Frank.
My name is Kinder.
I'm Karley.
I'm Justin.
That's right, that's our special guest, Justin. He's a black man.
He is, and his voice sounds amazing.
Amazing.
That's subject to change.
Yeah.
Actually, don't show that. Please just talk.
Just keep talking. You want me to keep talking? Bedtime story.
Serenade you with my soothing voice.
Give us your best DJ.
My best DJ?
Yeah.
Well, today we're going... We don't really know what we're going to talk about.
We had an idea.
We
don't anymore.
Creepy. We have ideas about not having ideas.
It's a podcast about nothing.
The underlying implications of children's movies...
Like the darker
implications of children's movies. Like, for instance, E.T., the entire premise of that movie is that adults are terrible people. Like, okay, think about it. There's a scene in E.T. Yeah. There actually is a cracked podcast.
Yeah, that's what we're turning into.
There's a scene in E.T. where the dudes have taken over his house. The government has.
Government.
And they come in.
America.
And fuck they, yeah.
The scene is the people from the government come in. The whole movie is about a kid hanging out with an alien. This alien is a lovable, kind of looks like an old pedophile.
kind of does.
Think about
with
it.
Long,
just,
thin
yeah,
fingers.
He just looks kind of creepy and old. But he's cute
let
and
me
adult.
Touch you.
turn on your heart light. The movie is about this kid hanging out with this alien, and then in the movie, the government comes in, takes over the kid's house, and they cover it in all the fucking plastic, and they walk in the house. They look more like creepy aliens coming into that house than E.T. does.
That was the point. I keep smacking
that. That terrified me
as a kid. That's the whole...
And that's why I don't like the movie. But I do love Reese's Pieces.
Reese's Pieces are awesome.
They're the best thing ever.
It wasn't for... Actually, I think Reese's Pieces were going to be taken off the market until E.T.
Yeah.
And that kind of boosted their popularity.
Well, M&M's were originally supposed to be in it, but they turned them down. Mars Candy turned them down.
The fools.
I thought Reese's was Mars.
Probably not at the time.
No.
This was years ago.
It was a long time ago.
Before everybody became one massive conglomerate.
Yeah, I actually thought Reese's Pieces were fairly recent. I mean, like, not recent recent, but like past 10 years recent.
Yeah.
No.
Remember Butterfinger BBs?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Butterfinger BBs.
Bart Simpson.
Yeah.
What was the line?
No butter, better little finger on my Butterfinger?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Eat my shorts. I can't do a Bart Simpson.
I can't. Well, it's a woman. That's part
of
it.
Yeah, Nancy Cartwright.
Eat my shorts.
Have
you ever seen
my voice is too deep. Eat my shorts.
Yeah, eat my shorts.
Eat my shorts.
Eat all my
shorts.
When
it comes to dark implications in children's movies, though, I don't even know where to start.
We can always talk about Toy Story and Sid.
Yeah.
Yeah, we just talked about that one. So in Toy Story, you know, you already know, a lot of people know that Andy's dad never shows up in the series.
Divorced.
Probably divorced.
Well, like I said, because in the first movie, they're moving to a smaller house, you know, and it's just the mom is there and she doesn't, and there's, I think, one shot where you can clearly see her left hand and she's not wearing her wedding ring, but it's like they're moving to a smaller house, and I think that was always the thing was that, they're getting divorced.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's that he was dead.
That would explain why he got a brand new, like, the must-have toy of the year for
because
Christmas.
Because it's like, we still
it's
love
like,
you.
We love you. Here, have this Buzz Lightyear.
Don't ever say anything ever again.
And that's probably why he's always distracted with his toys, you know?
Really?
But,
it kind of sucks if you think about it, though, because if they're getting divorced, how old was Molly? Molly was only, like, a year old
or Molly something. Was an accident, and...
Last-ditch attempt to save a failing marriage.
Either that, or it was another man's baby.
She is blonde.
Yeah.
Mom's blonde, too, though, right?
I don't know.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, mom's blonde.
Well, that could be still...
Yeah.
Mom's blonde, Andy's brunette.
Well, then eye colors, I don't know.
I don't know.
I haven't really... She
definitely
it could be that.
Doesn't look the same.
Yeah.
However, Justin, are you Molly's father?
What we were getting at about Sid,
don't
though...
Don't tell anybody.
Being as...
child support.
This is actually on a cracked article.
Keep on the DL.
The thing about Sid.
My illegitimate 3D baby.
Whatever.
Song of hymns.
My voice takes me to different worlds and just serenade all the
projecting voice. Sure, projecting the Toy Story universe and fuck Andy's mom.
I am. I'm the pizza man. That's what I am.
It's a pizza planet.
Planet you pizza me planet. The pizza
man.
Pizza planet. I'm here to deliver.
Pizza milkman. Milkman.
Pizza
milkman.
Pizza Planet truck is.
Did you ever see that
Wild
Now?
Yeah,
I love that one.
Oh,
the milkman. You never saw that one?
I don't think
oh
I saw
god,
that
we got to pull that up at some point. Anyway, Sid, the kid's obviously disturbed. You know,
yeah, his name's Sid.
Yeah,
I would be disturbed too.
He lives in this crappy house in this crappy neighborhood, and his room's just dark and shitty. His parents obviously don't have any fucking money.
Yeah.
And,
he's obviously a brilliant kid too, though.
Yeah. He shows extreme creativity in what he does with it, with the toys. Like, and he doesn't know that toys are a living thing. He's painted as this evil motherfucker in the movie.
Yeah,
but really, he's just creative as fuck. He can be an architect
or
an engineer.
He made the fucking baby robot head.
That thing was awesome, amazing.
I wish I could build something like that when I was a kid.
Extra creepy, but it was very.
Yeah. I mean, still, that shows extreme creativity and you know how.
Yeah,
and. They paint him up to be this terrible kid, but he acts out, but it's signature of coming from like a broken home. And when you have that kind of, you know, attitude and acting out and all that, you know, that's characteristic of that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then the toys, you know, they freak him the fuck out, you know, and do this whole thing, pull a prank on him, and he flips his shit, you know, he's got to think about for the rest of his life.
He was probably in therapy for a long time after that.
Yeah, nobody's going to believe him. Who the fuck's going to believe this kid?
Yeah. The toys can talk!
So they think he's actually psychotic, so they put him in into a, they check him into some psychological ward or something, you know.
Deputy. There's and a snake in my
face. He has to come to terms with the fact that he's been ripping apart and torturing these
living
actual living
creature.
Things.
Yeah, that's got to fuck him up. Why do you think he was the garbage man?
And later on in Toy Story 3, you see he's the garbage man.
Did he appear anywhere in Toy Story 2?
I don't know.
He's probably in therapy.
Toy Story 2? No, because there wouldn't have been a chance for him to.
Yeah.
Because they moved, and then...
What if the main bad guy, human bad guy dude, is Sid's dad?
What, Chicken Man?
Yeah, what if that's Sid's dad? That would explain why he has access to so many toys, even though he obviously comes from a poor home.
Huh, that would make sense.
Yeah, that's actually.
And they both kind of look similar if you think about it. You know.
Yeah.
Chicken Man.
Yeah, I think it's a stretch.
Chicken Man obviously is a lonely, sad man who has no love at all.
Yeah.
He's probably never had sex before.
Yeah.
But
gigantic Nick Beard.
Yeah.
Sound familiar?
Hi, Brad.
But, I mean, and he's got to think about this for the rest of his life, and you see him as this garbage man. He's got all this wasted potential.
Yeah.
Because he's so freaked out about these toys, you know, talking to him, that he can never do anything like that again. He can never build or create
anything again. Not to play, like, too inside baseball, but he's basically Bob. Think about it.
Yeah.
Bob is, like, an amazingly talented dude, super creative,
who could do whatever
he wants. Fixes airplanes for a living. Autistic, maybe.
And fix
Asperger's
airplane.
Most likely.
Yeah.
It's like there's just a spectrum now.
Well, fixes airplanes sounds like it's a really good, really fun job.
But it's not.
It's not. It's a basic mechanic job.
Yeah,
I do the same shit he does, but with machines.
Yeah.
And I don't like that
much.
I
fix machines.
I fix Terminators.
Yeah, okay.
They're gonna
uprise. Do you have any implications?
I'm going to draw on a complete blank right now.
I know one that I thought was interesting, and once again I'm pulling from Cracked. Like I said, one I thought was really interesting from Cracked was the whole thing about the Rugrats, and how it's all a figment of Angelica's imagination. So it's like Tommy was actually miscarried by Dee Dee and Stu. The twins were aborted. And the reason she made them twins, a boy and a girl, is because she didn't know what they were going to be. So she made that up. And then, it was a Chucky. What happened? Chucky died with his mom.
I thought Chucky was actually real.
Mm-mm.
No?
No, because it was all in Angelica's head. But I think the idea was that Chucky died when his mom died. Because I think she... I don't remember if she died during childbirth, but I know she died. Because they mentioned it in Rugrats Go to Paris. Mm. And then, is that all of them?
Yeah.
Phil and Little Tommy.
The black girl, Susie.
Yeah.
That I don't know.
Much like Susie, but it was Justin, all... is the token black guy of the podcast right now.
Anyway, but the whole idea was that Angelica,
foreign person.
No, that's you, Brad.
French person and
French girl, yeah. Token French girl.
Oh, what? Yeah, the one in the New Regrets after they go to Paris.
Oh,
the Asian girl? Kimmy?
Kimmy.
Oh, yeah, Asian.
Kimmy. She's Asian. Her mom is Japanese. Anyway.
Everyone else is so damn Aryan.
But the idea is that Angelica was neglected as a child because her mom was always working and her dad was always working, and so she was always by herself, and so she just made up all this stuff in her head. And that goes into, like, the Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends thing.
Love it.
Which was just, the comic. I mean, it's not that even a full comic thing. It's just that short comic where actually...
it's all in Frankie's head.
Frankie, that's what her name was. Yeah, it was all Frank, because Frankie's autistic, and it's all like, she's just her staring at
it's the end of globe. It's the end of St. Elsewhere.
Yeah. But it's still fucking awesome.
Which is the best way to end a television series. Ah, it's a television series about a hospital. Turns out it was all an autistic kid's imagination.
Yeah. Didn't that have Mr. Feeny in it?
I think so.
Yeah, he was one of the doctors.
As well as Steve Guttenberg, of the Police Academy series.
Guttenberg.
I can't think of any other ones, though. All I know is that Up is the most depressing movie in the first 5 minutes.
That
is.
Fucking first 5 minutes.
Oh, my kids watched that movie.
Hold that thought. We're going to take a break.
Okay.
Insert ad here.
Whenever I sit down for supper after working a 19-hour shift out at the old steel mill, I can't eat one bite without a bottle of Mama's old-timey Blue Bulls Working Man Hot Sauce, original recipe. It's so goddamn hot, you'll give your wife 2 extra beatings. Now that's tough. Texas tough. Mama's Blue Balls. Ask for it by name.
I am the Mind Freak.
Welcome back, everybody. We're back from our cupcake break.
Well, we need to do probably a little ad real quick before we actually get back started.
Everybody out there, would you please do us a favor and subscribe to us on iTunes and rate us 5 stars. We really appreciate it. Also, write us a nice review and leave us some feedback. And you need to like us on Facebook. That's facebook.com/SOGOpod. Also, you can follow me on Twitter @mostnotcoolman. That's actually my Twitter handle.
We've got a SOGOpod.com where we release episodes. It's technically Tumblr, so if you guys have Tumblr, you can follow us on Tumblr.
And at some point, blogs will be posted there. Yeah. And also,
we're on Stitcher.
Stitcher. If you are an Android user or an Apple user and need a way to listen to podcasts that's easy, it doesn't require downloading all that mess, download Stitcher. Streams the podcast directly to your ear holes. It's brilliant. And there's thousands of other shows on there that right at your fingertips. You can make custom playlists. There's smart stations. You can actually pick a podcast, and the Stitcher app will build a smart station based around that podcast. It's amazing.
Gee, Clem, that sounds like a whole lot of work.
Well, it's not.
Really?
It's not.
How easy is it?
It's really easy. You just go to the Google Play Store or the iTunes App Store, search Stitcher, and download it. Well, do you know how to do that, you fucking backwoods redneck hick? Fuck you.
That's a low blow, but I'll go and do that now.
Well, you know what? You should.
Fuck you.
I'm fucking done.
I'll kill you.
You want to go?
You son of a bitch.
Let's take this outside.
Fuck your day up.
Yo, you'll fuck a pig.
This town ain't big enough for the 3 of us.
Oh, shit.
It ain't big enough for 2 of us.
I'm Dirty Dan.
I'm Dirty Dan.
I'm Dirty Dan.
Anyway.
I'm Dirty Dan.
Anyway, we were talking about...
Who you call a pinhead?
Anyway, we're talking about the implications, like undertones, I guess, is a better way to put it.
Overtones, undertones.
Undertones and overtones of children's...
Midtones.
Things. Things. Just movies and TVs.
Things. Movies, TVs, books.
Stuff and sitch.
What were we talking about before the break?
What was that?
I don't fucking
Stuff and
remember.
Sitch.
Stuff and Sitch.
Stuff and Sitch.
Okay.
I mentioned that Up is the most depressing movie in the first 5 minutes.
That was it.
And the fact that, because my kids watch that movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's a really happy-go-lucky movie, but the first 5 minutes of that movie, fucking depressing.
Tearjerker.
Why?
In my mind, that first 5 minutes solidified that movie in my library as one of the better movies that I've seen, you know?
It's a great movie. Wall-E is another one.
I wish Pixar hadn't made Cars 2.
Yeah.
Because now they just make bad movies. They make good movies.
No, after they
make
Cars
2.
But
they don't make up-level movies.
Yeah.
After they did Cars 2, they came out with Brave, which is fantastic.
Some people would disagree.
I thought it was okay.
Fuck all of you.
I think the reason I kind of liked it was strictly because all the accents were so spot on to a level that it was difficult to understand them, and
like,
I loved it.
Well, yeah, the main dude who can't understand it is an actual Scottish dialect.
It's a dialect in Scotland. Like, it's a little lesser.
I would not
want to
meet a person who speaks like that.
The reason why you guys are about Brave is because it's a story about it's a mother-daughter relationship.
Don't go feminist
story.
On me.
I'm not. I'm saying
you have to have a vagina to get it.
I'm saying that it's true.
No, I will say
it is a story about a mother and a daughter. So no, it's not going to affect you guys as much as it affects, say, me.
I will say that Merda. I will say that she is probably one of the best looking characters I've seen.
You know who does
movie.
A voice in that movie?
Hmm.
Mo from Guts.
Really?
The referee.
Really?
Yeah.
Well,
Kevin James? No, not Kevin James.
Mo,
no,
the
other
referee. Chick.
Oh, the referee.
Yeah.
Oh,
thank you,
to
Mo.
Dude. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I had the biggest crush on that chick for the longest time.
Yes, Mo.
It was like, let's go play some sports, Mo.
Let me get up in them guts, dude.
Let me get up
okay,
in them guts.
Okay, Jay.
Let me find out.
Let me find out.
Let me get up in them guts.
You know, so Frank,
I'm climb that angle, Craig.
You want the whole pudding or
the
whole pudding?
The whole pudding. A bit of fanny fun.
Yeah. In case you don't know what the fuck we're talking about, which
Kevin
is
Smith.
Probably very likely.
Evening with Kevin Smith 2, Evening Harder in London.
It's a brilliant Q&A.
Watch it. It's fantastic.
It
just
is.
That one chick who wouldn't shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
Kept,
loved it.
Like she was having a real conversation.
That was the one
with
like,
him,
the.
And he was just like, shut the fuck up. I'm trying to do a Q&A here. Give the microphone away. Just, you know.
That was the one with the clit riff, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. Yeah, it was.
What am I missing? I feel like
you're
I'm
missing a very
everything.
Good Q&A.
Shit.
All I needed to hear was.
I wish we had brought it with us.
All I needed to hear.
I wish we had brought it with us because I'd say, like, after we're done, we'd just go in the living room and fucking watch it because it's awesome.
I know.
But we didn't bring it. No. It's at home.
I might can find it on YouTube.
Maybe.
Probably.
Yeah, most likely.
Anyway, that's beside.
But yeah, back to the topic at hand.
The tones.
I don't really want to do anything. I don't want to do anything else from Cracked because this is not Cracked the podcast.
I know.
Because
sure?
While we were outside, I thought of the SpongeBob one, which is that SpongeBob is actually the aftermath of the nuclear holocaust.
The Bikini Atoll.
Yeah, Bikini Bottom. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, what was that movie you guys watched the other day? It was guilt trippy as fuck.
It wasn't the other day. It was a few months ago, and it's called Grave of the Fireflies. It's a Hayao Miyazaki movie.
That movie.
And Hayao Miyazaki, for those who don't know, is the guy who founded
Studio Ghibli,
who did My Neighbor Totoro,
Howl's Moving Castle,
Princess Mononoke, Kiki's Delivery Service.
Yeah.
I can go through all of them. We have all of them.
Yeah.
But
Laura really, really, really loves all Studio Ghibli movies.
Yeah, well, we do too. That's why we have all of them. Grave of the Fireflies is a movie that wasn't done by Hayao Miyazaki, but it's done by one of the other people who works for him, and it came out I think in the late 80s or early 90s, and it's based in Japan.
Frank, your face right now.
In World War II.
This looks so sad.
Before
ooh, you come down with a case of the sads.
Before it's based before the A bombs, so before Hiroshima and
Nagasaki.
You failed
history
class.
Yeah, I know, I'm bad. Like I said,
sounds like a
call brand.
Nagasaki.
Anyway, but it takes place before that. I think
Nagasaki A bomb.
It's the black version of Kawasaki.
At the beginning of the movie.
Nigga, fuck it.
Son of a bitch.
We can say that because we have a black guy here.
It's okay. We're not racist.
You say it.
I'm a black man and I approve this message.
No, I want you to say it.
Nagasaki. Thank you for buying Nagasaki.
No, you can't say it like that.
Yo, dog.
Yo, dog. I heard you like Kawasaki and such. Never mind. I'm not kidding. Oh, my God.
Once you go black, you never go back. Because this motorcycle doesn't go in reverse.
No motorcycles go in reverse.
Exactly.
Anyway. 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 Grave of the Fireflies.
Black Ninja.
The most depressing movie ever.
It really, and like I said, it takes place in Japan in World War II, and it takes place when they start, when the incendiary bombs. So before the atomic bombs, we dropped the atomic bombs because we're terrible people. and it follows America. The life of a little boy and his little sister who's 3 or 4.
And I say she's 2.
She's really young. Yeah. I can't remember how old she is. But basically, it's just you watch it. You're done. Like I think when we finished watching it, we had to put our daughter to bed, who at the time was like a year and a half old. And Frank literally picked her up and just held her. And he was like, I love you so much.
Like, the entire movie is just... Okay.
It doesn't
guilt
trip
you. You know the movie,
it's not really a
guilt
trip. It's just sad.
Yes.
And the entire movie is just down note after down note after down note, and it ends on this happy ending.
It's not really even that much of a happy ending. It's kind
but
of
it's
like...
still like...
You have a job.
It's going
now.
To yeah, exactly. get better.
Welcome to the real world.
This movie is just down note after down note after down
and
note.
Then
and
then
it ends
and it's worse.
On an even bigger down note.
Oh my God.
So the
watch it.
Yeah.
Watch it. Just you'll watch cry. It.
Yeah. And you'll never want to watch it again. But you'll probably put it in like your top 10 favorite movies.
Yeah.
But you'll
it's
only
fantastic.
Need to watch it once.
It's... fantastic movie, but it's
I kind of
so
need to watch
like
it again.
Godfather.
I kind of need to watch it again because
well, that's what
the first bit of the movie, Brad was trying to watch it with us, and Brad was just being annoying the entire time we were trying to watch it.
Well,
and I'm like, I can't pay attention
such is the way
to this movie.
Of Brad.
Yeah.
What I told him was, it's one of those movies it. Where you can't watch it a lot, but it's got to be like one of those movies you watch like once a year
yeah.
type things because it's just so fucking sad.
Yeah.
But you have to, because it's still a great movie, so it's kind of like you have to remind yourself how good a movie is, so you watch yeah. it once a year. Like, I think Rain Over Me is another one that's like that, because it's yeah. so fucking sad you can't watch it a lot. Watch it like once
one.
A year. Huh?
I need to watch that one.
It's so good.
I've heard good things about
there's it. A, there is, Shadow of the Colossus is used very metaphorically in that movie.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
Like, he plays Shadow of the Colossus all the time.
Yeah.
And it's basically a whole movie about bringing down giants, which is what 9/11 was,
yeah.
was you know a, one little people bringing down giants, and it's like the whole
it's,
metaphor
it's
sad
ass movie.
BS of it.
It's a great movie.
Anyway,
Adam Sandler did a great job doing
Undertones.
A yeah, we're totally off topic, but no,
that was totally on topic. Actually,
well,
yeah. about
Rain Over Me wasn't, but because
yeah.
it's not a kids movie. But
maybe
no.
we should have just done like fucked up movies.
Grave of the Fireflies. It doesn't. It's not that it guilt trips you. Yeah, there's a little bit, but that's just like a personal thing.
The guilt
because
trips
it's like,
at the very end.
Yeah,
but it's really not. It doesn't. It shouldn't make you as an American
it's
feel
not
guilty.
Do, yeah.
The whole point of it was to make young Japanese people feel guilty for how bad they treat old people because of the shit that the old people had to go through in
yeah.
World War II.
I don't think that was it either.
No, that's what the guy
oh.
who wrote
oh,
the book
okay.
that it's based off of said.
Oh, okay.
Like that, you're getting the message all wrong. It's not about how terrible the nuclear bombs were and everything. It's and how bad it was for. It was just you little shits need to fucking learn some respect because these people went through fucking hell.
Yeah.
It's fucking yeah. It's, on the subject of Studio Ghibli, another one that's got a lot of undertones in it. Spirited Away.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
That movie is a whole big metaphor for child prostitution.
Really?
Holy shit.
Yep.
I never realized
yeah.
that.
Mm-hmm. But if you think shit. About it, it makes a lot of sense.
Wow.
She's a little girl who just happens to disappear from her parents.
Yep.
And gets taken to a bathhouse.
Where they put
where
her
where everybody
work.
Is a monster. And they
yeah.
put her to work doing this thing.
Oh,
yeah, and it's just
yeah.
yeah
it's,
I never thought about that.
Yeah,
actually, I really think that there's
mind blue.
There's a lot of like there's a lot of My Neighbor Totoro. Mm. There's a specific scene in My Neighbor Totoro where they're making the tree grow.
Yeah,
that tree growing is very reminiscent of a nuclear explosion.
Yeah, it is.
Like, if you look at how it's growing,
because I mean, it's literally
it looks
like
a mushroom cloud exploding. Yeah. I don't know why, because there really isn't anything else in that movie that's like,
other than the fact that the mother suffers from a mysterious illness that is assumed to be TB, which a lot of people got after.
But there was
the
just like some implications that it could have been radiation poisoning from you know, from just being around Hiroshima.
Because that movie takes place in the 50s, I think.
Yeah. Speaking of which, conspiracy watch. Speaking of which, conspiracy watch, have you heard about the radiation
thing? The Fukushima radiation? Yeah. It's not real.
It's not real?
It's not real. It's not real. Here's the thing. Number one, radiation...
Topic change.
It doesn't work that way. Like, it can't travel that distance. And the Geiger counter readings that he was getting on the beach were the same anyone would get. And in fact, on that particular beach, I watched a video by this guy named Thunderfoot. He's amazing. You need to watch his videos if you want to, like, learn some shit. Like, basically, he made a video talking about like how this particular beach this guy was on has black sand, which is magnetic sand.
Yeah.
Like, if you took a piece of metal on that beach and moved it over the sand, little bits of sand would connect to the metal. And he proved this by having a video, because he flies remote-controlled airplanes as a hobby, and he flew it over this beach because he lives nearby, and his plane crashed. He was like, what the fuck? And it turns out he flew so low that the sand got into the engine from just being near it, that it clogged up. It basically locked the engine up, and it crashed. So, like, the beach itself is just giving off enough radioactive activity on its own. And really, you could take a Geiger counter to anywhere and pick up radiation.
Oh,
that is levels, especially those that many clicks per minute. Like, if you that many, you're going to get that anywhere. Like, the fallout hasn't even reached, like, if it hasn't reached Tokyo, it's not going to reach the west coast of the United States.
Oh, I was talking about, like, the jet stream and all that.
Yeah,
and
I still don't see it.
It's just been around.
Not to mention, like, I think it's more just nuclear fear-mongering.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a big pro-nuke guy in my backyard. Please, just build a fucking... it's fucking clean energy. Yeah. They have videos of the wall. And people are like, there's a video of a plane. Like, it's like a propaganda video, like, do you want this to happen? And it's a video of a plane crashing into a nuclear power plant. And it's like this, they're like, do you want this to happen kind of thing? It's like an anti-nuke thing.
Yeah.
And they showed it, he is in the Thunderfoot's video, he showed a video of them testing the walls that's made out of. They're crashing jets into this wall, and the jet vaporizes.
Shit.
The wall is fine. The jet just turns to dust.
I thought of another children's movie, because that's what we're supposed to be talking about.
Yeah,
back on topic.
And it's not really an undertone, but it is one thing that I realized recently, thanks to Tumblr. Lilo and Stitch. Okay?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody knows the basis of Lilo and Stitch. It's a little girl whose parents died, and now she lives with her sister, and the child services is trying
government
to
gonna take my baby.
Yeah. Well, at the very beginning of the movie, after you're introduced to the aliens and everything, and you see Lilo feeding the fish peanut butter sandwich, right? Mm. And she goes to her dance class, and she says, she's telling him all about, like, I had to go to the store, and I had to get peanut butter, because all we have is tuna, and I can't give fish tuna, because tuna is fish.
Yeah.
And, her dance teacher asks her, well, why is this so important? And she says, Pudge, the name of the fish, she says, Pudge controls the weather. And if you look, all of the adults in the room just kind of go, huh? Like, they have this look on their face, like, oh my god. Because Lilo and Nani's parents died in a car crash when the weather turned bad, like, during a hurricane. So she's feeding this fish because he controls the weather. Because all the little kids.
That's also why she jumps on the little redhead girl when she says,
"That's
the little... stupid."
Yeah, she said, "You're crazy."
You're crazy.
And she jumps on her, starts fucking beating the
bitch
fuck out of her. Yeah, because it's like, because the kids didn't know, but all the adults in the room, you can see them like, oh, like, how do we handle this situation type thing?
Just let it ride.
Yeah, because it's like, and she says it later in the movie. She's telling, when Stitch finds her picture under her pillow, and she tells him, she said they died in a car crash. The weather got bad or whatever. And yeah. I think it was during a hurricane, but I can't remember exactly. But yeah, it was like, she's feeding this fucking fish because he controls. Oh,
yeah.
It fucking hurts, man.
I really want to figure out the tone, the underlying story to it, other than the fact that it's Little Mermaid, is Ponyo. Has anybody seen Ponyo?
Ponyo, fishy in the sea. Tiny little fishy, who could you really be? I fucking hate that movie.
It is probably one of the worst Studio Ghibli movies.
Well, it's a kid's.
It's definitely for kids.
There's Studio Ghibli movies that are just good.
Well, there's Hayao Miyazaki movies, yeah, particularly.
There's Studio Ghibli movies that are just good movies that for everybody. You've got stuff like Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind, which is one of my personal favorite. You've got Spirit Princess Away, Mononoke, which is fucking intense and brutal. Brutal and bloody, and that's not a kid's
Lupin
movie.
The Third, Castle of Cagliostro.
You've got those, and then you've got the Hayao Miyazaki movies that are the kids' movies. My Neighbor Totoro is one of them. Kiki's Delivery Service is another one. Ponyo is just straight up,
but
this is a kid's movie.
There's something weird going on in that movie, because the whole movie is about a freaking fish girl who appears out of nowhere. And the kid is obviously saying, this is Ponyo, this was my pet fish.
Yeah.
And the mom accepts this little girl into her home.
Mm-hmm.
No questions asked.
Why does that matter?
Granted, that mom, she was a very bad mom. If you watch that movie, you're just like, you were.
She's not a bad mom, she's just a really bad driver.
She's very stressed. She's a terrible driver. She leaves her kid in a, like, flood zone so she can go take care of old people at the home.
I don't know why that's important, though.
I don't know. But this fish girl.
Yeah, I know.
Magical fish girl. Obviously magical.
Remember when Caden was obsessed with that movie?
Yeah, I do.
I can't fucking watch it anymore.
Oh, yeah, I know what movie.
Yeah, that fucking movie.
Many a time I went over there.
The little redheaded little girl. Yeah.
I want to figure out the tones of that movie, because there's got to be something creepy. Because I might be like a arranged marriage implication there.
Could be.
Because that's really kind of the whole thing.
Well, The Little Mermaid is disturbing in the first place. Because, I mean, she's 16.
Oh, yeah. It's like the fact that, like, Little Mermaid is disturbing because Disney is full of sex-crazed weirdos.
Yeah.
Like, what? The poster for the DVD has the
dicks.
Ariel's palace, and it's just dicks.
Just dicks.
It's just dicks. It's a forest of dicks.
See?
And then
the boner
the Rescuers?
The Rescuers had the naked lady in the...
Yeah, one frame.
Yeah, you have freeze frame. You pause it and go frame by frame, and there's a naked lady in the window.
Yeah, of course, it's been removed since, but if you had an original print, you'd be able to see
it. Oh, I got the VHS. I want to be looking it up tonight. Naked ladies.
Yeah. Masturbating furiously.
I could be on the internet just looking at naked women. Instead, I'm going to...
I didn't watch this kid's movie and freeze frame it.
Where it's been like, I have the internet, but for some reason, the thought of finding this...
Jessica Rabbit.
This hidden naked scene.
Jessica Rabbit?
Or the Jessica Rabbit when she flies
out of
the shot.
When she flies out of the car and her legs spread for a second and she's not wearing it anywhere. Ooh. Any underwear.
You've become a detective for hidden
porn. But like, just like, I could just watch porn.
Yeah,
but no, I want to find this particular thing.
I want to challenge
furiously to it.
Yeah, or like just like a really good sex scene in a movie.
Can you do this for me?
What's that?
Can you just say you know the line from The Lion King? Is that a challenge?
What are you talking about?
Line from Lion King when Scar turns like
when Scar's
like,
talking
oh,
shit.
Maybe you shouldn't turn your back on me.
Is that a challenge?
Oh, a little deeper with it.
Is that a challenge? Or no, like, I sound like Batman.
It did sound like Batman.
I was totally Batman. Like,
say, where are the rabbits? No, I'm kidding.
Like a projector voice and say, Is that a challenge?
Is that a challenge?
Kinda.
Yeah, it works.
Why is this important?
Because of reasons.
Everybody just wants to hear me sound
You're
like
only
Mufasa.
Saying that because I've been saying that to you. You're only saying that because I say that to you like every time I talk to you.
I know, because of reasons.
I told him that the other day. I can't remember what I was talking about.
There's more
of that
stuff in
Disney. I was like, I did this because of reason. He goes, wow, you sure have a lot of reasons. And I was like, yeah, well.
There's something with Lion King, too.
Lion King in the clouds,
no,
it says sex.
No, it doesn't.
It really says special effects or
SFX.
Yeah,
it says FX.
Yeah.
But you could construe it as sex.
There's
Aladdin. Also,
take off your clothes.
Clothes.
And he, I swear to God, that's what he says.
Yeah. I've listened to it.
I've listened to it.
And I can show you the word.
Well, it's when he's on the magic carpet, and when he first goes up to Jasmine's room,
he says, "Hey, easy boy, down."
Yeah, he's talking
and
to
then he like whispers,
the tiger Raja,
"Take off your clothes."
Yeah,
like that.
I swear, it's so
like,
weird.
Take off your clothes.
It is. I swear.
He actually whispers, "Take off your clothes."
Yes.
Wait, when is this?
It's when he's okay. He's riding.
I was trying to tell
Jasmine's
him, but Frank's
palace.
Talking.
On the flying carpet.
Uh-huh.
And he gets off the carpet, and Raja comes up and starts trying to attack him because he's a fucking tiger, and that's what tigers do.
Yeah.
And he says, "Down boy, down boy." And you just see Jasmine. You don't even see Aladdin at the time because the shot's on her. Uh-huh. And he's like, "Down boy, down boy." And then in the background, you hear, "Take off your clothes." Like, really fast. It's so weird.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
It's weird.
There's this,
Baklava!
Sorry. What?
It's Frozen. Not many people.
Tippy toe, jump, jump and hop.